incredible time as we gather at the throne of our God and Father. And so we take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds as we come to worship that Lord and God. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, for desires and for whom the mystery is designed, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may love the Lord and worthy and magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commands and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate faults. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all trespasses, and grant that we may serve you.
Through Jesus Christ.
Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please do be seated for our readings.
The reading is taken from the first letter of John, chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed, but what we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called. for you. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
To live in a tent.
We are presented by Christ with the most amazing and beautiful of values, the most reassuring and encouraging of statements for those who are in pain and in need. That is the nature of our wonderful God. The God who brings us sunshine right now is the God who cares for those who are in pain, who are suffering, and those who are rejected by the world, those who are told they can't have tents. Now, in many ways, we might think in cozy West Whitefleet, sitting in this place, that how does that connect with our experience of life? Except, of course, it does in many ways. There may be a veneer of respectability, or maybe that goes quite deep as well. I'm sure it does, I'm very respectful in this field. But many, if not all of us, have had moments, if not profound stages of our lives, where there have been difficulties, where there have been pain. Things like cancer and divorce happen irrespective of family background and wealth. But it goes beyond that, because it's about how we are as a community. When Jesus addresses people in the Bible, we often miss it because we don't hear the distinction in English, but he addresses it in the plural. When he says you, he's talking about us all together. So when you mourn, it may not be you personally, but your sister or brother may be mourning, and they are blessed because God cares for them. And therefore, as God's children and made in God's likeness, we reflect that and are encouraged to be also in that way of being. We bless them, we encourage them, we love them, because that is what Christ commands us to do. This is how we recognise the saints. We recognise them as those who are loved despite their wounding. We recognise them as the ones that society may not always recognise, but who God notices. And we're called to notice each and every one of them, even though sometimes that may make us feel uncomfortable. And I'm sure you all know people who have that amazing gift. And I encourage you to emulate them. I encourage you to develop those gifts and qualities within yourself so that the whole community might burgeon and flourish in that way. One of my favourite books is The Great Divorce by C.S. Lewis. It's an allegorical novel about a man who goes on a tour of what's not quite clear whether it's heaven or hell or some intermediary land. But he meets various people, and each of their stories is a metaphor for where they are in their relationship with God. I just want to read you one little extract. He notices someone. He notices a beautiful woman who is surrounded by a whole entourage of spirits who are rejoicing and singing. And he turns to his guide, and this is what he says. Is it? I whispered to my guide. And you can tell that he can't quite believe that he thinks he's about to encounter Mary. This is what his guide says. Not at all. It's someone you'll never have heard of. Her name on earth was Susan Smith. And then he adds quite prosaically, and she lives at Goldersbury. She seems to be, well, a person of particular importance. And this is the response of the angel who's guiding him. Aye, she is one of the great ones. You've heard of her at fame in this country, and utterly ordinary, unnoticeable woman who loved many, cared for many, influenced many, and had a profound impact on many in her quiet, gentle faith. She outshined some other Teresa, and no one noticed her. And this is the kind of saint to which we are called to be. We are called to care without counting the cost or worry about whether or not anyone noticed. And in so doing, we build up a beautiful community of humility, of one that says to the rest of the world, not knowing better than you, but isn't this a better way to live? Isn't this a way that makes such a difference? We know that there is so much pain and also pain and evil being inflicted out there in our world. Imagine what a difference it makes when each person, each community chooses that better way, that way of the Beatitudes, which encourages care and love in the face of difficulty. We have a God who knows what pain, what betrayal, what violence, what mourning is like. He doesn't say that will go away, but rather I walk with you in it and through it. I know it, I understand it, and I will be with you in it. What an amazing gift. What an amazing joy and experience which at the same time we discover many millions have come to know throughout the ages. And it is our gift and responsibility to hand on to the next generation, that they too might receive that freedom in their hearts and minds of knowing they are loved, come what may, and that is the gift that can help them through life and to be a blessing to many others too. And so my encouragement to you today is to look back at those words. Dig out your Bible, that maybe the side you've made it maybe a little bit dusty. It doesn't matter. Because it's there waiting for you with those words of freedom and liberation from the pain and suffering of this world, with God's love outflowing from it. Let it be a nourishment to you and an encouragement that this place may flourish and be a blessing to many. Amen. We stand to proclaim our faith in that God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father,
as they celebrate their dedication festival today. So the response to our intercessions to the phrase, Father, be your spirit, is bring in your kingdom. Father, by your spirit, bring in your kingdom. We pray for the coming of God's kingdom. You sent your Son to bring good news to the poor, sight to the blind, freedom to captives, and salvation to your people. Anoint us with your Spirit. Rouse us to work in his name. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to bring help to the poor and freedom to the oppressed. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to tell the world the good news of your healing love. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to those who mourn, to bring joy and gladness instead of grief. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to proclaim that the time is here for you to save your people. Father, by your Spirit,
bring in your kingdom.
Lord of the Church, hear our prayer and make us one in mind and heart to serve you in Christ our Lord. Amen.
goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Truly we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning and formed us in your own image. Through him you have freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born of a woman and to die on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you have sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit, and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Thank you.
by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you,
but only say the word, and I shall be.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be delivered in sacrifice. Send us now the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. I'm closing here.
Well, you got away with it, didn't you? Just a couple of things. First of all, to welcome everybody here this morning and to say please do join us for coffee in the Cornerstone Centre, which for those of you who've never been here before, it's through that door over there, and we'd love to see you then. And secondly, to say that tonight there is the service for all souls, and it would be lovely to see as many of you as would like to come. This evening for 6:30. It's a sung service, so the hymns and the choir will be singing. So it would be lovely to see those of you who have somebody in your hearts that you want to remember this evening. And lastly, the Christmas fair. Probably noticed the boxes at the back. I have, and they're empty. So that's down to you. I can't put them on. So please, 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 if you've got any of the goods that we're looking for and they're on the notice sheet, please make sure that you bring them in so that we've got stuff to use. And the one thing that isn't on there, of course, are the jars over here, which are filling up, I'm pleased to say. Those are coming on, Bridget, we're doing all right. But the last thing to say is cakes. I know that everybody nags about cakes, but I don't make them, so... But my wife's all clued up, she's got all the stuff ready. Okay, I think that's me, thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. My name's Chris, for those who don't know me, Chris Anderson, and I'm one of a small group in the church who are trying to make our church a little bit greener. And it's leading on from the theme we had in September around God's creation. And it's quite easy during storms like the storm we just had to feel quite helpless. We know the weather's changing, we know climate change is affecting everybody, and particularly those who haven't got all the shelter we have, like people who are living in tents, who are homeless, and who are in parts of the world that are more affected than we are. And it's very easy to feel completely powerless. We can't do anything, you know, particularly when we see decisions that governments around the world maybe that aren't the right decisions. But we can do little things, and those little things will add up and make a difference. So a small group of us, including myself and Anthony there, are running an eco church group, and every week in the newsletter we will be offering little tips for you to consider to make those small differences. And there's a nice segue there, because one thing you can do, it's really good to reuse and recycle. So anything you've got at home that you don't use that someone else might enjoy, or maybe that bottle in the cabinet that's been sitting there for years you don't like, bring it and put it in those boxes at the back, and then someone else will have the pleasure of it, and we'll bring in some more funds from the church. So just something to look out for. And if you are interested in helping in any way, then please speak to myself or Anthony or Scott, who's down in the congregation as well, or by any of the ministry team. Thank you.
Wonderful. So, service tonight, Christmas fair, and get your eco credentials and have a Christmas fair all in one go. Wonderful. Thank you. Shall we stand up? Father, from whom every